Okay, welcome to day 5 of short course. Today we have Dr. Girish Pahwa from University of California, Berkeley. He is a postdoctoral fellow and BSIM program manager in Berkeley. He is leading all the BSIM model development at Berkeley site. Today, however, he will talk about his research, which he has been doing in last, for past 6 years or so. He graduated from IIT Kanpur in 2019. He is a prolific researcher. He has published large number of papers, and his papers are very well cited in all the, upcoming papers in NC or FAROFET. So, Girish, to you.
Yeah, thanks for the introduction. Let me share my screen.
Okay, I think I have not allowed, or is it okay? Yeah, it's okay, it's working fine, yeah.
Okay, so should I get started?
Yeah, please, and you will be leading this, and once you are done, Girish, you may end the meeting for all.
Okay. Yeah.
So, and I would encourage participants to ask questions in between, because this topic is something which is might be new for you. And Girish is a very good teacher in a sense; he explains it very well. So feel free to ask in between. Girish, is that okay?
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. So treat it as a course itself, I would say, and have plenty of time. So. Okay, so let's get started. So I'm going to be talking about this negative capacitance FET, and I've been working on, as Professor Yogesh told you, that for quite a bit on it. And so let's get started. So I'll be talking about these things. So this is the outline. So first I'll talk about why we need this steep switching or these steep switches in the first place, and what is negative capacitance, how can we get it practically, and all of those things, how negative capacitance actually works in terms of energy, in terms of capacitance matching and all. And then I'll be talking about the modeling of NC FETs and analysis on the device level. And we have usually these two types of configurations for NCFET. One is MFIS, the other is MFMIS. And I'll talk about the difference between these two and how they can be modeled, what's the difference in the electrical characteristics, et cetera. And then I'll briefly talk about the circuit performance of NCFET. So why do we need steep switching in the first place, and how we can achieve that with the help of negative capacitance FET? Let's see. So on the left side, you see this diagram shows an IDVG curve. And these blue lines are actually your conventional FETs. And if you know, there's this concept called substitute swing, which represents your, which shows the amount of gate voltage required in millivolts to cause a decade change in the current. And this has a fundamental limit that it cannot be reduced below 60 millivolt per decade. So that's the fundamental limit on your conventional FETs. And why this is important is because if you might have observed that, if you would have seen that the frequency of the processors this has now basically saturated. It's around 3 to 4 gigahertz now, and we are not being able to increase it more. So the primary reason is that when you try to increase the frequency, you have to correspondingly reduce the supplied voltage too, because you don't want to increase your power density. Now we are at a level that if you increase the power density more, you just cannot afford it without deteriorating your device performance. So for that, if you want to reduce your VDD, So your on current is related to your VDD, right? And not only VDD, it also depends on the threshold voltage. So when you try to reduce this VDD, you have to correspondingly reduce the threshold voltage too, so that your on current does not degrade. But if you see your off current is actually exponentially dependent on this VT. And if you reduce this threshold voltage, your off current will increase exponentially. As you can see here, if I try to maintain the same performance, the off current is actually going exponentially higher. And why this is happening is because this subthreshold swing does not change when you reduce this VT. So this is a constant, and this cannot be reduced below 60 millivolt per decade. So this part is actually incompressible. That's why these characteristics are shifting like this. So from all of this analysis, what we get is that if we have a switch, if we have a transistor which has a steeper slope, say below 60 millivolt per decade, we'll be able to reduce the VDD further without degrading your on current and while maintaining this off current, ISO IOF condition. So this red curve shows such a switch which has a subthreshold swing less than 60 millivolt per decade. And you can see that the same on current can be achieved at a lower gate voltage. And we have also been able to maintain the off current. So requirement is that we need a switch which can show steeper switching below 60 millivolt per decade at room temperature. And your NCFET actually offers that. So this is actually a schematic diagram for the negative capacitance FET. So what extra thing this negative capacitance has over the conventional FET is that it has this ferroelectric layer in the gate stack on the top of this oxide layer, which is usually your SiO2. This is a buffer oxide layer. So you just put a ferroelectric in on top of this, and you get a negative capacitance FET. So how does this work? So for that, let's see what subthreshold swing expression is. So subthreshold swing is given by this del VG over del log 10 of ID. And let's factor this term into these three factors. So let's focus on each of these factors. So this del psi over del log of ID, psi is, by the way, surface potential. This is the term which limits the SS to basically 60 millivolt per decade. This is 60 millivolt per decade term. Then you have this del V int over del psi S. So what this V int is basically the voltage at this interface, ferroelectric and oxide interface. So there's this term, and then there is another term, del VG over del V int. So to check this term, let's make a capacitance divider circuit of it, equivalent capacitance divider circuit, which is shown here. So there is this ferroelectric, and there's this oxide, and the CS is the semiconductor capacitance, which is coming from here. And the V int is the voltage somewhere here. So if you see this term, del V int over del psi S, this is your conventional body factor, which is given by this 1 plus the semiconductor capacitance divided by the oxide capacitance to the power minus 1. And this factor is actually always less than 1. So if you forget about this factor, this is 60 millivolt per decade. This term is less than 1. The overall quantity is always going to be greater than or equal to 60 millivolt per decade. Now, because of the ferroelectric, you have this additional term, which we are writing as 1 over AV. So AV is given by del V into over del VG. Right? So it's like a it's like how this V changes as a function of VG and the differentiation of that. From this capacitor divider circuit, this can be obtained as CFE over CFE plus C int. The C int is this internal capacitance of the baseline MOSFET. And CFE is the capacitance of this ferroelectric layer. So what happens is that if CFE is negative, this AV is going to become greater than 1, right? So what is going to happen is if this AV is greater than 1, it means it's behaving like a gain, and that's going to actually reduce your subthreshold swing. And if it becomes so much that AV is greater than 1 over M, you can also get the substitutional swing, which is less than 60 millivolt per decade. So that's what the negative capacitance is. So we'll see how a ferroelectric can actually achieve this negative capacitance behavior. So what basically is capacitance? So capacitance, you know that C is equals to dQ over dV is a differential relation between the charge and the voltage. So what a negative capacitance will be, if C is less than zero, it means that as your voltage goes down, your charge will increase, or vice versa. There are more definitions of the capacitance. So capacitance can also be related to the energy curvature. So it's basically equal to inverse curvature of the free energy density. G is your free energy density here. You can understand this relation using your normal capacitance, using your normal relation for a linear capacitance, which is parabolic. G is equals to your Q square over 2C there. And if you double differentiate it and take inverse of that, you will get C. So which shows that this relation is correct. So what a positive capacitor will mean in terms of charge and voltage is this. As you increase the voltage, your charge is going to increase. In terms of energy, if you see, so this is a parabola basically, right? What a negative capacitor will mean that voltage is increasing, charge is decreasing. And because your C is going to be negative, this G will be an inverse basically parabola. Inverted parabola, right? But in practice, what we get is not this inverted parabola throughout the charge range. What we get is something like this, a double well type of shape of energy versus Q. And there is a region of charge where you have this inverted parabolic curvature. And in this particular region, your CFE is actually negative. And ferroelectric materials are actually exhibit this type of energy profile, a double well type shape profile. So let's try to understand why this is the case. And before that, I'll talk about what exactly is a ferroelectric material. Let's see that. So there are two types of dielectric materials. One is called paraelectric. One is called ferroelectric. So ferroelectric material is your normal dielectric material, which you would have seen everywhere. So ferroelectric material in terms of polarization and electric field means that there will be no polarization when your electric field is removed. So at E equal to zero, your polarization is also zero. So that's a characteristic of ferroelectric material. It's a normal capacitor, dielectric capacitor. What a ferroelectric capacitor is a bit different. So at E equal to zero, what you get is actually two possible states of polarization. It can be up-oriented or down-oriented. And if your ferroelectric is isolated, it is not connected to anything else. And if you apply an electric field to it, you will usually get a hysteresis type of curve, which is shown in this figure. So ferroelectric materials have this remnant polarization. Even if your electric field is zero, there are two possible states to it. So what are the requirements of the ferroelectricity? Let's see that and how this positive polarization or negative polarization state is coming when you remove the electric field. So the requirements are, as we saw, One of the requirements we have already seen, that there should be a spontaneous electric polarization. And that comes because of the non-centrosymmetry of the crystal, actually. So what centrosymmetry and non-centrosymmetry means is that, let's take the example of lead titanate, which is at high temperature acts as a paraelectric material, and at low temperature it acts as a ferroelectric material. So this is the figure shown on this left side. This is a lead titanate arrangement of atoms. And this is a centrosymmetric phase of the lead titanate. So it's a paraelectric phase. Centrosymmetry means that there is no net polarization, if you can see in this unit cell. If you add all the dipole moments, the result is going to be zero because there is a perfect symmetry in there in this, and it's called centrosymmetric. The other one is the other phase of this lead titanate is what we obtain at low temperature. So when you reduce the temperature below a particular temperature, this transforms into a new phase where this center atom, which is the titanium ion here, it gets shifted either towards this side or this side. So you will have this shifting either on this side or this side. And when you have something like this, you have a net dipole moment because your symmetry of the unit cell is lost. So ferroelectric material will have some kind of this non-centrosymmetry in its unit cell. And the other requirement of the ferroelectricity is that this polarization states, two possible polarization states, either up or down, it should be reversible actually. So with the help of electric field, you must be able to go from one state to the other state or vice versa. So when you apply electric field, say in the opposite direction, so you can switch this polarization into the other direction, and you when you apply say upward electric field, you can switch it back. So these are the ferroelectric materials which are non-centrosymmetric and have this switchable property. So how mathematically we can represent these dielectrics, and what's the physics behind it, what's the theory which we can use? So there's a thermodynamic theory called Landau theory of non-linear dielectric materials. It works for ferroelectric as well as ferroelectric material. That's a general theory. And it says that your free energy can be expanded in terms of the order parameter, which in case of ferroelectric or ferroelectric material, it's polarization and given by this expansion, where alpha, beta, gamma are constants. Alpha is further a function of temperature. Usually it has a linear temperature dependency. T naught is a some temperature, which is called Curie temperature. And alpha naught is a constant greater than zero. And E is electric field, E is polarization. This beta and gamma are other constant parameter, which are usually weak functions of temperature. And we usually assume these to be temperature independent. Depending on the material, this alpha, beta, gamma can be different. Further, this G, the dynamics of G, how G evolves with time is given by this theory called Landau-Kolesnikov theory. And this is the relation between the rate of change of polarization and del G over del P. Using this relation, we can get the time evolution of the G. If we are working in steady state, let's say, so all the differentiations with respect to time should go to zero. So this del G over del P is going to become zero. And you will get a relation between electric field and the polarization using this. So this is the relation we get. E is equals to 2 alpha P4 beta P cube and 6 gamma P5. So how this theory can explain the paraelectric and the ferroelectric materials, and what's its relation with the negative capacitance? Let's see. So assume that this alpha is, for example, positive number. If you will plot this G expression with alpha being positive, what you will get is a normal parabolic curve. And if say we are working at zero electric field and you use the relation between E and P and you put zero here, and for alpha greater than zero, you solve this equation, what you will get is a single root of this equation, which is real root at P equal to zero. So for alpha greater than zero, you just get a single root, and this represents your paraelectric material. What happens if alpha is actually negative, for example? If you solve this equation for alpha negative, what you get is actually three real roots, which are, one of the root is actually P equal to zero, and the other two roots are some finite quantities, symmetric plus minus PR, where PR is given by this. And if you plot this energy expression, what you will get is a double well type of energy profile, which is the picture which we get for a ferroelectric material. And if you see in this, as I told you, there is this particular region where your parabolic region is actually inverted. So it has a negative curvature. And in this region, your capacitance is going to be negative. But is it a stable state among the three routes? This, this, and this. This is the maximum energy, maximum energy point. So at E equal to zero, if you leave your ferroelectric, it's not going to stay here. It's going to either go to this state or this state. This is an unstable state, and these two states have equal energy, so either of them can be occupied, depending on the history of the material. But our negative capacitance is somewhere here. So how to encroach? How do we encroach here? How do we stabilize this position? Let's see. So if you try to, so this was the previous slide showed you what happens at E equal to zero. If you apply an electric field, in the case of a paraelectric material, you know that it's going to be some relation where E at E equal to zero, P is going to be equal to zero. It's a simple line, maybe nonlinear. That's a positive capacitor. What happens if you apply an electric field to that ferroelectric material case? So in that case, this alpha is going to be negative. And because of this, if you plot this E versus P relation, what you will get is this S-type curve. And in this green region, you can see that it has a negative slope. This is polarization and electric field. And negative slope of a charge versus electric field, what does it mean? It means that there's this region is a negative capacitance region. But how do we enter this? How do we stabilize this? Is it possible to stabilize this in an isolated capacitor? Let's see. Let's see what happens when an electric field is applied. So as I told you, this this E equal to at E equal to zero, P equal to zero point was maximum energy point. So at E equal to zero, this is not going to be occupied. So either we will be here or here. So let's assume that we are here. And the corresponding energy profile as a function of polarization will be something like this, and we are somewhere here. When you apply the electric field, this state starts to become more stabilized compared to this state. So your parabola will, your double well energy profile will something look like this, where you are here, but the we have still not been able to switch to this state. So this region is basically composed of metastable states. So metastable state means that you have an energy state which is more a stable state, but you are still in a higher energy state because you have not been able to switch. You have to cross this barrier. So when you apply the electric field, this barrier actually becomes smaller and smaller and smaller, and at particular electric field, this barrier actually disappears, and this ball, this state actually rolls off in this more stabilized state. So at somewhere here, we are in this oppositely oriented polarization state. But are we able to enter this? No, because the path taken by the ferroelectric is not this. It's when you apply the electric field, it goes this, and there's this jump, and we are here. Now, if you reduce the electric field, the same thing is going to happen. You will first reach somewhere here, and when you apply the oppositely oriented electric field, this state is going to become more stable, and at some particular field, you're going to switch. So in this total trajectory of this states, you are nowhere entering this region. So how do we enter this region? So one thing becomes very clear that in an isolated ferroelectric capacitor, if you try to apply the electric field, what you will get is a hysteresis curve, and you won't be able to enter this green region, which is the region of interest to us. So what we can do is that to stabilize this negative capacitance, what we do is we connect a dielectric capacitance, a positive capacitance series with this ferroelectric capacitance, such that the total free energy of the system has a minima in the negative capacitance region of the ferroelectric. So what this means can be understood from this diagram. So in this diagram, I've plotted different energy profiles for the ferroelectric, for the dielectric, and the total system. So ferroelectric profile is a double well profile, which is given by this red curve. The dielectric profile is this green curve, which is your normal parabola. And the total energies of the system is going to be equal to the sum of these two, which is this blue curve. If this positive curvature of this green curve is large enough such that the total sum of this ferroelectric plus dielectric energy has still a minimum here. So in that case, your total energy, if you see the total system, it is still stable at P equal to zero, even if the ferroelectric is in the negative capacitance state. So that's the criteria to stabilize your negative capacitance. So mathematically, we can also see this in terms of capacitances. G is equals to GF plus GD. GF is ferroelectric energy, GD is dielectric energy. And Q is related to your electric field and polarization using this relation. If you assume that the system is negligible, Q is going to be equal to approximately PF and PD. PF is ferroelectric polarization, PD is dielectric polarization. So charge is approximately equal to polarization. We have assumed that. Now if you differentiate, double differentiate here on the both side, you get something like this. And you know that for a stable system, your del 2 over del 2 g over del q square should have a minimum, right? If you want a stable system. So the energy curvature should show a minimum. So if you apply that condition, so this del 2 g over del q square must be greater than zero. Now these are double differentiation of the energy with respect to charge. They can also be represented in terms of the capacitance. So inverse curvature represent your capacitance. So this term is going to be your 1 over total capacitance. This is your 1 over CF plus 1 over CD. This is ferroelectric capacitance. This is dielectric capacitance. That's a simple relation of the capacitances which you get in, which you get for the capacitances in series, and the total capacitance must be greater than zero. If we assume that this CF is negative, for example, this curvature, if you see, it's a negative here, right? So CF in this region is going to be negative. And I'm going to replace this CF with minus mod of CF if we apply that and use this condition. So you get that this relation, this expression of this C total must be greater than zero. And from this, you will get that mod of your CF must be greater than or equal to CD. So the condition for the stable system to stabilize the negative capacitance is that the absolute value of the ferroelectric capacitance must be greater than the dielectric capacitance. So that's the condition for the stabilization. If we are able to stabilize the negative capacitance, you will also see that the C total is actually greater than your CD. So the C total is usually, if you see for a system which has two positive capacitors in series, the total capacitance is always less than least. But in the case of a negative capacitor and a positive capacitor series connection, the total capacitance is always higher than the dielectric capacitance. This condition is also sometimes used as a signature of negative capacitance in experimental data. So these are some of the experiments which shows your ferroelectric dielectric series connection So in this figure, you can see that this blue line is actually your dielectric capacitance. This red line is your total capacitance. So it's a combination of lead zirconium titanate and strontium titanate. This is a dielectric and this is a ferroelectric. Sorry, I lost my connection. I don't know, for some reason I'm not being able to share my screen. I'm sorry, just please wait for 2 minutes. It's...
Yeah, Greece, please restart. Okay.
I'm sorry for that. It's my internet connection. So let's see, where were we? So I think I covered this part, but let me just quickly tell you again if I lost here. So what I was trying to tell you that in experiments, this negative capacitance has been observed, and the signature of the negative capacitance is that and the signature of this negative capacitance is that your total capacitance becomes greater than the dielectric capacitance. And this has been observed in several experiments. So this suggests that this negative capacitance phenomenon is real. And recently, there has also been a demonstration of this S-type curve of the polarization, which was published. So what they do is that they apply the pulses of different amplitudes, and then they calculate the charge corresponding to that, and then they plot them against each other, and what they get is this S-type curve. And correspondingly, if you try to plot the energy, what you will get is this double well type energy profile, which is showing that in this region the capacitance is actually negative. So what you are getting with the negative capacitance is that your total capacitance is becoming greater than the dielectric capacitance. In terms of energy, what this means, you know that the energy of dielectric is given as Q square over 2C, right? And with the help of negative capacitance, the total capacitance has become larger. So Q square over 2C means to store the same amount of charge, Q will require less energy because now your denominator is higher, right? So with the help of negative capacitance, you can reduce the amount of energy supplied to store the same amount of charge. So with the mathematics, we can see that, the C is negative. So that's why the total C has increased. So that's why this is happening. But what physically is happening? Let's see that. So in this ferroelectric and dielectric system, the ferroelectric acts as a rechargeable battery actually, and the energy actually can be recycled. When you charge a capacitor, usually say a positive capacitor, so half of the energy is always lost. Half of the energy gets lost either in terms of heat or in terms of radiation. Even if you have zero resistance, for example, your capacitor is not connected in series with any resistance, the half of the energy will still get lost in terms of radiation. So that's a fundamental limit of charging. With the help of ferroelectric capacitance, this fundamental limit actually can be broken. So when you apply the input energy to a ferroelectric dielectric system, what happens is that this ferroelectric starts to deliver some energy, which is stored in the phase of the ferroelectric in the form of the arrangement of atoms and its lattice structure. It gives up that energy to the dielectric. And what now you require is that you require a smaller input energy to put the same charge on the dielectric, because some of the energy is actually coming from this ferroelectric. And when the discharging happens, so usually all of the energy of the dielectric will get lost in either in terms of heat or radiation. But in case of ferroelectric dielectric system, ferroelectric actually captures some of this energy, and it captures the same amount of energy it lost in this the charging process. So it's basically a rechargeable battery. It gives up the energy in charging, and it takes the same amount of energy in, when the discharging. So this is actually increasing the efficiency of this charge-discharge process, because you are being able to use this energy loss during discharging. So why this is happening? You can understand this using this energy versus polarization diagram. So that's parabolized dielectric, this double well energy profile is ferroelectric. And this black line is the combined energy. So let's see. Say we are here at zero charge. There is no charge on this ferroelectric dielectric system. And we want to put some charge Q on it. For that, we'll apply an electric field. And let's say we're gonna put some amount of charge here. So for that, the dielectric energy has to increase up to this point, right? So there's this increase in energy of the dielectric, which is required, you will have to supply the energy so that it can be stored. It's a positive change in the energy. But in the ferroelectric, this point is the maximum energy point. And if you supply the some amount of charge, the energy of the ferroelectric is not increasing, it's decreasing. So ferroelectric is giving up some of the energy which was stored in it in its phase here. It was stored in the form of its ionic arrangement, in the form of its crystal structure. So the ferroelectric is giving up that energy. That energy can now help the dielectric to charge, because now you will have to supply smaller amount of the external energy to give the same amount of charge to the dielectric. So this is the phase energy which is being transferred here. And in that discharging process, the ferroelectric captures this energy back. So let's now talk about principate structures and what's their modeling, what's the analysis, how the device characteristics look like. Let's see. So there are two types of ferroelectric NCFET structures. One first is called MFMIS, other one is called MFIS. So in the MFMIS structure, there is a metal gate in between the ferroelectric and the oxide. So because of the presence of this metal gate, this surface is actually equipotential surface. So the potential here is constant. So what we can do is that we can just separate this ferroelectric capacitance and the underlying MOSFET and just connect them using a wire. I mean, physically, they may not be connected using a wire. Physically, there may be a metal, but the equivalent picture is this. And this makes the modeling of this device very easy, because now you have a separate ferroelectric capacitor and a separate MOSFET, and the MOSFET models, you can choose any MOSFET model which are there already available. And you can separately model the ferroelectric, and in the, say, SPICE netlist, you can just connect them and you're good to go. For MFIS structure, the situation is different. This metal is not present here, so the ferroelectric is directly deposited on this buffer oxide. And because now there is no metal layer here, when you apply a finite drain voltage, the potential from here to here is going to change. So that will also cause a change in potential at ferroelectric oxide interface, which is a constant here, and it's gonna change here from source towards drain. So that makes the modeling of the MFIS structure a bit difficult. So let's see. I'll first focus on the MFIS NCFET and its characteristics. So as I told you, there's this metal gate and we can treat them separately. That simplifies the modeling. So ferroelectric part will model using the LK equation, and the baseline MOSFET part, we can model it using different models depending on the structure. For example, for FinFET, you can model it using the BSIMCMG. If it's a bulk device, you can model it using BSIM bulk, or if it's FDSY, you can go for the BSIM IMG, and so on. And what we need to do is do this experimental calibration. So because the ferroelectric and dielectric are acting as separate entities now, so we can calibrate them separately. So this shows the polarization as a function of the ferroelectric voltage, and this is some experimental data. We can fit the Landau curve against this data and extract the parameters alpha, beta, and gamma of the Landau equation. In this case, this is an ytterbium doped HFO2 material. And by the way, these HFO2 based ferroelectric materials are becoming popular now. They are important, particularly because we want these ferroelectric material to be CMOS process compatible. And we know that HFO2 acts as a dielectric anyways in your state-of-the-art devices. So what we have to do additionally is that just dope it with some dopant, which can be a rare earth metal or sometimes it can be silicon also. So you dope this HFO2 with some dopant, and what you get is the ferroelectric phase, depending also on the annealing condition and all. So that's there. For the BSIM CMC, in this particular example, I've chosen a 22 nanometer FinFET node, and you can calibrate this, the IDVG at, this is at 50 millivolts, this is at 0.8 volt. So after the calibration, what we can do is we can solve these two models self-consistently, and that's done in the Verilog-A code. So there are two separate Verilog-A code, or you can just make one separate one single Verilog-A code and put everything in there, or you can make two files also. So you have to solve this two models. One is the Landau-Kolesnikov model, and the other one is compact model of MOSFET. You can also replace this compact model of MOSFET with the TCAD data. So that can also work. And if you solve this self-consistently, the output you're gonna get is your V internal and the ID. So that's a flowchart of the modeling scheme. And the condition of the self-consistency is that because the ferroelectric and the internal MOSFET, they are in series, so the charge must be equal. The charge on the ferroelectric must be equal to the charge on the gate of your baseline MOSFET. We already saw this voltage amplification. Let's see that again. So this was the capacitance divider circuit I was earlier talking about. It has this ferroelectric capacitance, oxide capacitance, semiconductor capacitance. And I've already talked about this stuff. So let's see this AV term again. From the voltage dividing condition, we found that this AV is given by this mod CFE or mod CFE minus C internal. CFE is ferroelectric capacitance, C internal is the baseline MOSFET capacitance. And so we want this AV to be greater than one, right? You want this amplification from here to be greater than one, because you want to suppress this substitute swing. And it goes into the denominator. So that's why we want this AV to be greater than one. For that, a large AV can be obtained if CFE and C internal are close to each other. But mind it, CFE, mod of CFE must still be greater than C internal. So that condition cannot be violated. Otherwise your AV is going to go negative, and that's an unstable condition. So CFE mod should be greater than C internal, but it should be close to C internal. So that's called capacitance matching. If the capacitance matching is good, your AV is going to be high. So that's what we try to achieve in an NCFET. And that can be achieved using several different techniques, and I'll discuss them. So this shows the charge and capacitance plot. So x-axis capacitance, right, on y-axis is the charge. And it shows several different quantities. So this C int is your normal baseline capacitance, this pink line. And these, this black line, red line, and the blue line, this is the ferroelectric capacitance, actually mod of ferroelectric capacitance for three different thicknesses. So let's see how the thickness of the ferroelectric affects this capacitance matching I was talking about. So you know that VFE is equals to this DFE times this. So this is actually electric field. Electric field times the DFE will give you the ferroelectric voltage drop. And from this, you can calculate your ferroelectric capacitance, which comes out to be equal to this. When you increase your TFE, your mod of CFE will decrease. So that's what is happening here. So this T for TFE equal to 8 nanometer, you are here. When you increase the TFE to 11 nanometer, your CFE reduces. And for TFE 14 nanometer, CFE actually can also go below this C internal. So how does this affect the capacitance matching? For this, the capacitance matching is least. This is more closer. The capacitance matching is going to be very high here. And if you go below that, this region actually becomes unstable, because now your gain in this region is going to be negative. So what the system will do is that it's going to skip this region of instability and make a hysteretic jump. So for these type of conditions, when you have CFE less than C, and you will see a hysteresis in the electrical characteristics of the NC FET. The corresponding gain is shown here for 8 nanometer and 11 nanometer. I've shown it for the two different VD, but let's focus on the small VD for the time being. So this black line is for the 8 nanometer. And the gain we are achieving is somewhere around 3.5, definitely greater than 1. That's what we want. But when you increase the TFE to 11 nanometer, this red line, you can see that the gain is very high here. So it's like 35 or something like that. So by increasing the thickness of the ferroelectric, we are able to achieve a larger gain because now your capacitance matching is good.
Sir, I have a little bit question.
Yep.
In the previous slides, sir, this capacitance matching diagram can be obtained in the TCAD or it can be obtained through the MATLAB.
So here I have obtained this using your compact model and the ferroelectric model. So actually, you can obtain this using the MATLAB too. So what you will do is you have this Landau-Kolesnikov model, right? And from that you can obtain a relation between the Q and C, and you will get these lines, right?
Yes,
so
yes,
that's not going to change in the TCAD also. But right now I'm just talking about the MFMIS. For MFIS, that will change. MFMIS, because of the presence of the equipotential surface, your VFE will simply be equal to this. So that's there. For this particular line, what you can do is you can either obtain this from a compact model or do an independent TCAD simulation, and you can extract the gate charge, and then you can plot how the gate capacitance varies. And yeah, you can generate these plots. And from this relation, CFE over CFE minus C, and you can get this type of tag.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So in this slide, I show the IDBG characteristics, and I'm going to focus on the subthreshold part right now. So this shows the IDBG for different TFE. TFE zero means your baseline MOSFET, your conventional MOSFET, and as you increase your TFE, the thickness of the ferroelectric, you can see different things happening. So let's focus first on the subthreshold regime. As your ferroelectric thickness increases, what we can see is that your subthreshold thing is improving. And for this blue line, you also get this hysteresis type of curve. So we can understood it from this relation. You know that as your thickness increases, your capacitance matching increases, so your gain will increase. And if your gain will increase, that's going to suppress your subthreshold swing. So that's why it's improving. And when your stability condition gets violated, your more CFE becomes greater than C internal, which was the case, by the way, for TFE equal to 14 nanometer, we'll get a hysteresis type of curve. So yeah, and this SS versus VG is shown here. You can clearly see here that as you increase the TFE, SS becomes smaller and smaller, and at particular thickness, it also goes below 60 millivolt per decade and up to 50 millivolt per decade we are being able to achieve in this figure. So here I'll be talking about the on region of the NC FETs. So on region means we are talking about the current here in the strong inversion region at high VG. So as you can see that not only the SS improves, but on current also increases as you increase your ferroelectric thickness. So what does it mean? The on current amplification actually cannot be achieved with the help of a differential amplification. So what we focused in the last few slides was actually a differential amplification. So del V into del VG type of thing. That cannot give you a current which is higher than the conventional FETs. So for that, what you require is actually an absolute amplification. So by absolute amplification, I mean that your V internal should be actually greater than the VG. So for example, this, you have this VG, and if you want the higher current at the same VG, your V internal must be greater than the VG. And actually this ferroelectric can achieve that. So in addition to the differential amplification in the subthreshold region, we actually get an absolute amplification which can increase the on current. So let's see how we are getting that. So in the negative capacitance region, our MOSFET is going to be stabilized at some state on this curve, in this green region. And if you see, for any given charge, for a positive charge deposited on this gate, the voltage drop across the ferroelectric is actually negative here. A negative voltage drop means that this V int is going to be larger than the VG, which is actually causing your current to go higher. Why this is increasing with increase in the ferroelectric thickness, we can see with the help of this diagram. So if you plot, if you do a load line analysis, by the load line analysis, I mean that you will plot Q versus BFE using the Landau-Kolesnikov equation for three different thicknesses, say. So this is the smallest TFE, this is larger, and this is even larger TFE. So as you increase your TFE, you will see that your S curves will start to get tilted. And for the baseline MOSFET, you will get another relation using the baseline MOSFET theory. You will get another relation between Q and VFE, which will give you this type of a load line. And the intersection of these load line with any of this QVFE Landau curve will give you the stable state, the state of the system. So for TFE, which is the smallest, your state of the system is somewhere here. And as you increase, you can see that this load line intersect these Landau curves at more and more negative VFE. So for this, the negative VFE is somewhere here. For this, negative VFE is somewhere here. And for this, we have even larger negative VFE. So as you increase the ferroelectric thickness, your negative voltage drop across the ferroelectric is actually increasing. And that's why the absolute amplification being greater than VG. So that's also getting better and better with increase in the thickness, and that's why you are getting on current improvement. So it's an absolute amplification you're getting.
Sir, I have a question in this slide.
Yep.
Sir, in this graph for TFE is equal to zero, it's basically a baseline FinFET.
Yes.
So we can comment that for a negative capacitance FinFET, our ION will increase and VTH should be increased. VTH should be decreased.
The can ION should increase and VT should decrease.
Yes.
The VT should decrease. Okay. So regarding the VT, I'll talk about it later. In this figure, yes, the VT appears to decrease, but I'm showing it at a low VD, VD equal to 50 millivolt. In fact, I was going to show you that in the next slide. When you apply a larger VD, instead of a decrease in the VT, you may get an increase in the VT too. That can happen. But even if you focus in this particular plot, the lower VT is not a problem, because you're not getting an increase in the subthreshold current, right? So that's why the low VT is a problem. And here, there is no increase in the off current, because with the low VT, your subthreshold swing is also improving. So that is actually compensating that effect, and the off current is still it's still where we want it, right? And you are getting an increase in the on current. So on to off ratio is actually improving, right? So does that answer your question?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Sir. Hello, sir.
Yeah, please go on.
Sir, I have a doubt. The off current also get amplified, right?
Off current may or may not get amplified. In this particular case, it's not getting amplified. It can get amplified if you have a larger doping in the channel. So what will happen in that case is, say if you have a larger doping in the channel, and I'm talking about right now, say a long channel MOSFET. So in that case, because even at VG equal to zero, you have some depletion charges, and because of that, you will get some amplification. Your V internal will be actually greater than the VG in that case. And if that's the case, internally you are getting an amplified V internal, your off current will increase. But in the modern MOSFETs, your doping is not that high. And particularly if you are talking about modern MOSFETs, for example, FDSY and FinFETs, not the bulk MOSFET. And short channel MOSFETs we are talking about. So then what happens is that the fringing charges also come into picture. And instead of getting an amplification in the subthreshold region, what you get is actually V smaller than the VG. I'll show that to you later. But there's something called reverse short channel effect, which happens in the case of NC FET. So because of that, your VINT is actually smaller than the VG, and that suppresses the subthreshold current. And if it doesn't suppress, at least it won't make it larger. So which is the case here? It's a 22 nanometer FinFET, and the short channel effects are dominant in this case. And because of those short channel effects, the current is actually not increasing. I'll show that later.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
So this is the characteristics. These are the characteristics, ID VG characteristics at high VD. So you can see that in the on region, you are getting an improvement with an increase in the thickness, as we have seen in the low VD case also. You are getting an improved SS, but if you see with an increase in the thickness, your off current is actually decreasing here. Right, in the last slide, the off current was almost at the same point for all the thicknesses, but for the high VD case, with the increase in the thickness, the off current is actually reducing and your SS is improving. Another characteristics which is evident here is that the width of the subthreshold, width of this hysteresis is actually smaller than the last case. Here, the width of the hysteresis is larger. So let's try to understand all of these. I'll focus on this off current improvement later. Let's talk about the hysteresis for the time being. So at high VD, you are getting a smaller hysteresis. So why is that happening? So when you actually increase the VD, you reduce this C internal. When you increase the VD, your C internal goes down. When you increase the VD, because of the drain to channel coupling, your charge gets reduced, and that brings down this C internal, and that actually disturbs the capacitance matching between the CFE and the CINT. And because now the capacitance matching is smaller, so your width of the hysteresis gets smaller also. So I can explain that more from here. So this curve stays. For example, here, this is the 14 nanometer case, which shows the hysteresis. Assume that the CINT gets smaller because of the VD you apply, right? And then what's gonna happen is that your capacitance matching will get disturbed, and you will get something like this. Now, earlier the difference was this much, so width of the hysteresis was larger. Now, because they are the capacitor matching has disturbed, so the difference is smaller, so your hysteresis bit also gets smaller. So let's go to the next slide. Yeah. So before going any further, let me show some of the experimental demonstrations of this NC fit. So this left side shows a demonstration of the NC fit with the 1.5 nanometer hafnium zirconium oxide. Actually, these are the thicknesses we want for state of the art NC fits, because of the fin pitch limitations, actually. So you cannot actually use a ferroelectric which is 10 nanometer, 15 nanometer in thickness for state-of-the-art MOSFETs. So for those, you will require the thickness of the ferroelectric to be around 2 nanometer or less. So this was demonstrated in the IDM 2016, and they're getting a 52 millivolt per decade substantial swing. So that's a good number we are getting here. This is another demonstration shown in the IDM 2015. And in addition to a smaller substantial swing, which was in this case 58 millivolt per decade, they're also getting a larger on current. So this red line is your NC FET, and this backline is your baseline MOSFET, and the on current is approximately 50% larger than the baseline case. You can also see that in the IDVD. So our theory regarding the on current improvement and the absolute amplification, this experiment suggests that that's also correct. This is another demonstration where they were getting a 56 millivolt per decade substantial swing. This is a PMOS and germanium channel. And if you see the capacitance as a function of the gate voltage, you see this peak here. So this peak is the total capacitance, and this blue line is your baseline MOSFET capacitance. And in this region, this red curve is actually greater than this blue curve, which shows that your total capacitance is larger than the dielectric capacitance, which is your MOSFET in this case. And in this region, we are getting a negative capacitance, actually. This is another demonstration by the GlobalFoundries on the 14 nanometer node. So they integrated this ferroelectric layer in their 14 nanometer technology process, and they fabricated an NC FinFET, and they're getting a substantial swing which was smaller than the baseline 14 nanometer technology. So these red curves are for the NC FinFET, and this black curves are for normal FinFET. This is another demonstration which was published in the Nature Nanotechnology in 2018. And this is for MOS2 channel. And the baseline substantial swing is somewhere here, but with the help of the negative capacitance effect, they are able to suppress this substantial swing to near 60 millivolt per decade. So I showed you the high VD case earlier, IDVG high VD case earlier. So let's now see that more closely. So in this figure, I show the IDVG for two different VD, the VD 50 millivolt and the VD 0.8 volt for two different thicknesses, TFE 8 nanometer and TFE 11 nanometer. So these black lines are 8 nanometer case, red lines are 11 nanometer case, and solid lines are your 50 millivolt, and the dotted lines are 0.8 volt. So let's focus on one of these. Let's focus on this red curve first. This is 50 millivolt. When you increase the VD, what you get is a positive shift in the threshold voltage. So your dotted red line is actually here, right? Which means that unlike your normal short channel MOSFETs, when you increase the VD in case of an NC FinFET, which is a short channel NC FinFET, your threshold voltage actually increases instead of decreasing. So it's like a negative double effect. It's like a negative drain-induced barrier lowering, or you can say it's a drain-induced barrier rising. And I'll show you later that there's actually a rise in the barrier. So this is from TCAD, but I'll talk about it later. So it shows that when you increase the VD, instead of dropping, this barrier actually increases. So let's try to understand this in other terms for the time being. So as you increase the VD, your gate charge drops because of the drain to channel coupling. The gate charge is going to go down. Now, because your ferroelectric is stabilized in the negative capacitance region, a decrease in the charge means that there is an increase in the ferroelectric voltage drop. Because of that, your internal MOSFET voltage is going to go down because VG is equals to your Vin plus VFE. The sum of these two must be constant for a given VG. So if it's going up, it should go down. So going down means that actually your effective threshold voltage of the device has increased. So that's why there is this negative double. So if you plot actually Vin as a function of VD, you can clearly see that as you increase the VD, your V internal actually drops. And the impact is more for a larger thickness. The drop is more for a larger thickness because for a larger thickness, our negative capacitance effect is more. So that's why we can expect that all of these negative double effects are also going to get amplified. In this figure, you can also see that the shift in between the black and dotted curve is smaller and shift between the red solid and red dotted curve is larger. So it's a larger thickness, a smaller thickness. Double as a function of TFE is shown in this figure. So for very small thicknesses, say we start at somewhere around zero, the double is positive because the negative capacitance effect is very weak. When you increase the TFE, negative capacitance effect starts to come into picture and your double drops down at a particular thickness, your double actually becomes exactly zero. And if you increase the thickness further, your double becomes negative here. So this plot shows the IDVD characteristics. So the same effect which leads to a negative double effect in the IDVG, it will lead to a negative differential resistance type of effect in the VD. Because when you increase the VD, your internal voltage is actually dropping down. So that will cause this reduction in the current in the saturation region. And this reduction in current can also be shown in terms of the GDS versus VD. So GDS is the transconductance, output transconductance. So in this particular region, your GDS is going to become negative. And when we increase this VG, the peak of the GDS increases actually. Let's see why that happens. And I've also shown ID versus VD for different thicknesses. So you can see that as you increase the thickness of the ferroelectric, this NDR effect becomes more and more prominent. And at very high thicknesses, you can also get a hysteresis curve, something like this. So again, when you increase the VD, your QG goes down, your ferroelectric drop increases. That causes this Vint to drop, which reduces your ID here. Why the peak of the GD is more negative for a larger VG? Because the drain to channel coupling is actually higher for VG larger, for the larger values of the VG. So large VG means you are in the strong inversion region. And when you increase the VD there, the reduction in the charge is actually larger in this case. And the drain to channel coupling is larger. So that's why reduction of the ID, it's getting amplified here, which is causing this peak to become more and more negative. Here you can see that when you increase the thickness, your negative capacitance effect will increase, and that will make this curve to drop more and more. These are some of the experimental demonstrations of this negative differential resistance effect. So you can see there, VMOS here is actually V internal in our case. So V internal is a function of VD. So this is published in Nature Nanotechnology in 2018. It's a MOS2 channel NC FET. And when you increase the VD, your VMOS is actually decreasing, and they have plotted it for several different values of the VG. And the drop is actually more for the higher VG values. And if you plot the ID, VD, you can see the negative differential resistance regions. This is again a published paper in the JDS 2018. And they have done it for different thicknesses. So as you can see that when you increase the ferroelectric thickness, your GDS is becoming more and more negative. And the minimum GDS as a function of the overdrive voltage is plotted in this particular figure. And you can see when your, this is for PMOS, when your gate overdrive is larger, the minimum GDS is more negative, but that's what we expect. And for a larger thickness, when you go from this to this to this, your peak GDS, the minimum negative GDS is getting more and more negative. And that's the corresponding IDVD curve. So that was the modeling of MF, MIS, and CFET. And now I'll talk about the modeling of MFIS and CFET. So if anybody has any questions, so they can ask. Otherwise, I can just go further.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, there are some reports like where they have used this air gap as a air gap transistor, or you can say suspended field effect transistor as a negative NCFET. Also, Yoga sir have some journals on this SGFET. So what are the possibility of, and what are the technology behind this air gap transistor?
Yeah, so the air gap is actually, so fundamentally actually what you need is a double well type of curve to obtain this negative capacitance. And I'm not quite familiar with that particular air gap transistor, but what I think is using the air gap method, you get a similar type of picture what we get in case of a ferroelectric material. But all of these things actually come down to how we can control these processes and things. So ferroelectric based NCFETs are getting popular because we have found CMOS compatible ferroelectric material, which is hafnium dioxide and the doped hafnium dioxide, for example, hafnium zirconium oxide. So that's why it looks promising. But with the air gap, I'm not sure how they are going to control it, and it's going to create all complexities and all. So that's why maybe not many people are even working in that region. Maybe for a long channel, it might be okay, but for smaller channel, for very small lengths, the industry is going to trust what they have actually seen. So they have seen that this HFO2 works very well in state-of-the-art MOSFET. So that's why they are kind of sticking to that. But in terms of research, yes, you can say that there can be possibilities also for the air gap or the beam type of beam bending and air gap transistor, what you are talking about.
Okay.
Yes.
Sir, we have observed that for higher VDS, the VTS shifting is positive.
Yes.
So my question is that for negative capacitance FinFET, due to the voltage amplification, for lower value of VG, the strong inversion will create at earlier stage of early. So the voltage, the threshold voltage should be lower. Why it is increases?
No, I didn't get. Could you repeat? The strong inversion should be
Achieved at a lower gate voltage as compared to baseline. Yes. So VTS should be lower.
Yes, that happens at a smaller VD.
But at higher VD, the reverse has been observed.
Yeah, because there are two things happening here. So you have this VG, and you also have this VD, right? So yes, the gate charge is not alone in the control of the VG. It's also controlled by the VD. When you have a very large VD, you are definitely going to reduce some gate charge. And that effect is actually more, you can say, dominant in this short channel case. When you have high VD and you increase your VD, your gate charge will definitely decrease if you maintain a constant VG here. So in the subthreshold region, so what will happen is that when you increase the VD, your gate charge is decreasing, the ferroelectric voltage drop will actually increase. So that's what causes this increase in the threshold voltage.
Okay,
but yeah, now you can also say that, okay, then why, when VG is large, for example, in the strong inversion region, the on current is still increasing. So it means we are still getting an amplification there. I'll come back to this later. So at high VG, actually your gate control becomes more effective, and that becomes the dominant, you can say, the dominant knob. And that's why we get normal amplification there.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir,
so let's talk about the, yeah, please.
How doping hafnium dioxide with silicon affects the Curie temperature and paraelectric effects?
So when you dope HFO2 with any of these dopants,
yeah,
say for example silicon, so HFO2 normally is your paraelectric, right? When you dope it with the silicon, it's going to reduce its Curie temperature. Basically, it's going to give you a possibility of the ferroelectric phase.
Okay.
Yeah. So at high temperature, your ferroelectric your material is still going to be paraelectric, but at low temperature, below a particular temperature, Curie temperature, it can attain ferroelectric phase. Now, it also depends on the annealing condition. For example, if you have prepared your material, the ferroelectric material you're trying to prepare, at different annealing condition, you can actually get different phases of the same material.
Yeah.
For some different annealing temperature, you may get basically in maybe an anti-ferroelectric phase also, right?
Yes, sir.
So it also depends on the annealing condition.
Okay. So one more question. How can we extract charge density using TCAD? Can we directly do it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Centaurus allows that. I don't know about the Silvaco, but
no, Silvaco Centaurus is, definitely. It won't be.
Centaurus or COMSOL even. Yeah. Okay. So let's move on. If nobody has any other question. Okay, so modeling of MFIS and CFETs. So modeling of MFIS and CFET is definitely going to be different because now we don't have the metal layer in between. And this V internal is going to vary from source to drain. So how do we capture that? That spatial variation along this longitudinal direction. So the issues with the analytical modeling, if we try to model this using analytical relation, so what we get is actually implicit equations, and they are tedious. These implicit equations will take several iterative numerical several iterations to reach an accurate solution. And we solve these implicit equations using numerical methods. So that's not going to work when you are working for spice modeling. For example, you want to simulate a circuit which has a large number of transistors. So this type of methodology will lead to a huge amount of time penalty, and no circuit designer would like that. So what we want now is a compact model where we are still allowed to use these numerical methods, but what we want is that our solution should be achieved in a very small number of iterations, say just two or three. So 2, 3, 4, these are the standard number of iterations that are used usually in the industry standard models. So we'll try to do that. So that's our goal. Well, let's see why we are running into problems here and why there's this implicit equations. So we know that the Landau theory, the drop across the ferritic is given by this equation. Is this expression alpha qg plus beta qg. So instead of q, I have now gate charge density here. So I'm applying it along a vertical line at a given position, say x. And this relation holds true. And we also have another relation using the voltage balance. So this Vg minus Vfb must be equal to the voltage drop across the ferroelectric plus voltage drop across the oxide plus surface potential. So which are these three terms? Vfb is the flat band voltage. So this is another relation. And Vfe we can put from this equation here. So we get a relation between Vg, Qg, and psi s. Actually, Qg and psi s are unknowns here. So for a given Vg, we want to calculate what is the charge density at this given x and what is the surface potential as this at this given x. We also know that this Qg and psi s, they are related using your MOSFET theory. So Qg is a function of psi s using this monster equation. So now we have two equations, these two equations, two variables, and we can solve them using the numerical methods, and God knows how many iterations it's going to take to achieve an accurate solution. So that's there. So this shows that how this implicit modeling is coming into picture. On the top of that, you also have to calculate the current. I mean, the charge density is not going to work. What you need is actually terminal current, and that can be achieved using this relation between the charge and the current. So you can integrate this inversion charge with respect to the Fermi level in the channel from source to drain. So at source, the Fermi level is zero. At drain, the Fermi level is at VD. And you can obtain the current, but this QI itself is an integral, because you'll have to obtain the QI, you will have to integrate in this direction. So that leads to this double integration type of expression. And this is called usually Pausa double integral. And you know, I mean, you will have to again use some numerical methods for this integration, and it's going to increase your complexity. So all of this process is actually very slow, and we want to do two things. First, we want the QG to be obtained within 2-3 iterations if you are using numerical methods. The second thing we want is that we want an explicit expression of the ID in terms of the QG or the surface potential. So these double integrals are not going to work. So with that in mind, let's see how a compact modeling works. So usually in compact modeling, what we do is that we divide our region of operation. We divide our MOSFET behavior into different regions. We will focus on one particular region and try to approximate our expression in that particular region. And one by one, we'll cover all the regions, and then we'll try to join them using some smoothing function. And that will make our initial guess for further numerical methods, which we are going to use to calculate the actual charge density. So let's try to obtain a good initial guess for those numerical methods. And because it's an initial guess and it's not a final solution, so we can make some approximations depending on the region of operation. So let's see for what we do for depletion and weak inversion regions. So for depletion, you know that the QG can be approximated by this expression in terms of surface potential. So there's a linear term of the surface potential, and there's this exponential term of the surface potential in this relation. And if you put this QG in the voltage balance equation, what you get is this big expression, and there are several terms. So here we can see there are two types of terms. One is linear surface potential term, here, and another one is exponential surface potential term. when we are in the depletion or the weak inversion, actually this this surface potential is going to be very small, and this exponential term will be actually smaller than this surface potential term, the linear surface potential term. So we will actually approximate this first. So it's a two-step process we are going to follow. So first we approximate these exponential terms using a Taylor series, and we assume that the surface potential is, say, some psi wi naught. Using that, if we put here, we replace everything with this psi wi naught and exponential terms we expand using the Taylor series expansion, what we will get is a cubic equation, and the roots of this cubic equation can be calculated explicitly. So there are explicit methods to calculate these roots. You don't have to apply any numerical method here. And you will get some initial psi wi naught. So it's our very rough guess of the surface potential here. Now, in the second step, what we use is use psi s equal to psi wi naught only in the exponential term. So in the first step, we replaced psi s with psi wi naught everywhere. Now we are just going to replace it in the exponential terms, because we think that these terms are not that important. So we are just doing this approximation for these terms in the second step. And if you put that in this equation and rearrange the terms, you will get another cubic equation which you can solve. And finally, we get an updated guess, which is given by this psi wi. So this is our guess even right now. Even after these two steps, what we are getting is not the final solution. It's just a guess which we are going to use for our numerical methods. In the strong inversion region, the QG can be approximated using this equation. And again, we are going to make some approximations. So first, we assume that in the strong inversion region, the surface potential is clamped at 2 phi f plus phi naught plus Vc. So this phi f is your Fermi potential. Phi naught is some number, usually 5 or 6 times the thermal voltage, and Vc is your Fermi level of the electron. And we can calculate using this relation the corresponding charge density, which we denoted by QSI naught. Then we rearrange this into this expression, and in the log term, in the strong inversion, this log term is actually less important than the linear terms. So this linear term, you will see they have a greater dominance in the overall expression compared to this log term. So what we do is that what approximation we got in the first step, we will only apply that in this log term, and then we will calculate the roots of this equation. It's going to be a cubic equation again, and then we get an updated final, you can say, the guess for this strong inversion region. We saw the depletion region, weak inversion. We saw the strong inversion. What about the moderate inversion or the in-between region? So for that, we assume that QG is a cubic function of the VG. So it's totally an empirical relation. It's called polynomial smoothing. And we apply some boundary conditions at the two ends of this equation. So one end is going to be in the weak inversion, the other end is going to be in the strong inversion. We apply some approximations there. We apply some conditions of the continuity of the charge. We apply the continuity of the first derivatives with respect to VG. And when you solve, when you put all of those things in this, what you will get is the values of these coefficients C0, C1, C2, and C3, and you get this expression. So now we have covered all of these regions, and we can use our numerical method. So this is the final numerical method which we are going to use. It's called Halley's method. And it's an advanced, you can say, Newton-Raphson method. So Newton-Raphson method is up to here, G over G dash. And the Halley's method improves the accuracy of that by multiplying this with this term. And using this, we are able to actually get the gate charge density within 2 to 3 iterations using our initial guesses. So this this slide shows the comparison of our calculated charge density and surface potential using numerical method, which we are saying our compact model and the actual implicit model, where we don't care about the number of iterations and we solve the equation I showed you in the first slide of this MFIS compact modeling. So we solve that implicit, and we don't care about the iterations. And if we compare these two methods, what we are getting is a very good agreement, and not only in the charge density, even in the capacitance, which is the derivative of this. And we use different thicknesses. We also compare the surface potential as a function of VG. There also we're getting a very good agreement with the implicit model. And we also plot the derivative of the surface potential here. And you can see that even these sharp peaks are captured well. So that's a very good method to obtain the numerical solution within two to three iterations. So next is the modeling of this current, the analytical modeling of current. We want an explicit expression of the current. For that, we are going to use the gradual channel approximation. And in that, the I is given by the sum of two components. So this is the drift current, this is the diffusion current. You integrate both sides from 0 to L, integrate with respect to the position. Correspondingly, you integrate here with respect to the charge densities, QGS, QGD. Here you have inversion charge density, QIS, QID. And after the integration, you get these big expressions, and you'll have to integrate them further. So for this integration, everything is in terms of QG, but the QI is left. So QI can be related to the QG using QI is equals to minus QG minus QB, where QB is your further related to the surface potential using depletion approximation. And finally, the QI you will get is something like this. And if you plug in here, you will be able to integrate this. So this will result into this big expression. And for the diffusion part, you can simply, because there is simply this dQi, the integration you will get is very simple, and QID and QIS can be calculated using this relation. So what does this QIS and QID means? So the QIS is the charge density at the source side, QID is the charge density at the drain side. So you are going to solve your all of that charge density calculation, which I showed you earlier, that will be done at two places, one for the source side, another one for the drain side. Where is the difference is going to come from? So difference is going to come from the Fermi potential, actually. So at source side, the VC is going to be equal to zero. For the drain side, the VC we will apply will be equal to the VD. And if we plot all of these, so you can see the IDVG, IDVD, GM, GDS, and this shows the validation of this model against the experimental data for two different sources, and model seems to capture the trends of the data very well. And someone was talking about that increase in the off current. So here you can see, actually, instead of decrease in the off current, here I'm getting an increase in the off current, because this is a long channel MOSFET, it's a bulk MOSFET, and I've used quite a bit of this channel charge, channel region doping. So I think I used 5×10^17 per centimeter cube here. So that's causing this large rise in the off current in the NC FET with respect to this brown line is your baseline FET. So let's see how these two compare against each other. So now onwards, I'm going to show you actual two-dimensional simulations, which I did using COMSOL. And so the 2D simulation will also cover the short channel effects and everything else. And the models used are these. I'll not go into the details of that. So this plot shows, this slide shows the IDBG characteristics of the baseline FET, MFIS FET, and MFMIS FET for different lengths. And for the baseline FET, you know that as you reduce the gate length, your characteristics are going to become worse. Your substitute swing will become worse. Your off current will increase. So the usual trends for the MFIS, the trends look something like this. For MFIS, the trends look something like this. More clear picture we can see in this VT versus length plot and the SS versus length plot. So let's focus on this first. So for baseline, when you reduce the channel length, you get this threshold voltage roll off, which is a usual trend. But for the MFMIS or the MFIS, these two NC FETs, you see that the threshold voltage, instead of decreasing, it's actually increasing, right? And more for the MFMIS compared to the MFIS. So that this is MFMIS, this is MFIS. And I've shown here the two cases. One is with spacer, another one is without spacer. So you can see that when we have the spacers in place, the impact is even larger. For without spacer, there is a threshold voltage increase, but not that much. And at very low lengths, the threshold voltage starts to follow its usual trends again, because the short channel effect starts to become dominant here. We'll see how these trends come. And in the substitute swing, as you reduce the channel length, what usually happens is that your substitute swing degrades, it increases. But in case of NC FETs, it's actually decreasing. MFMIS, MFIS, and the impact is more prominent for MFMIS again. Let's see. So to explain that reverse VT shift we observed in case of NC FETs, we'll focus on the electric field lines of how the electric field lines look in case of NC FETs. So let's first focus on the baseline FET. This is the potential two-dimensional potential diagram of a baseline FET, and these arrows are the electric field lines. Because of the space charge regions here, what these electric field lines do in the subthreshold region is they induce negative charges on the sides of this gate metal. Negative charges here, negative charges here. Now in case of the baseline FET, they may not be that important, but in case of NC FET, these fringing field lines are very important. So how they affect the NC FET case, let's see. Let's see the MFIS case first. So we have this ferroelectric layer on the top of this oxide, in addition to this normal SiO2. So you have these fringing field lines similar to the baseline at the source, at the drain. By the way, I have taken VD equal to 50 millivolt case here. So the VD is small here. Because of the negative permittivity of the ferroelectric, the electric field lines will be actually opposite here. If you apply the boundary condition, the electric field is going to be actually in the opposite direction because it has a negative permittivity here too. Because of this, because of these down arrows of the electric field, what is going to happen is that there will be a voltage drop across these regions. So actually there is no amplification now. So voltage is not increasing from here to here. It is actually decreasing. In the direction of electric field, the voltage always decreases, it drops. So the potential here is actually smaller compared to the applied potential. Potential here is smaller compared to the applied potential. What this is going to do is that this is going to increase the barrier height in these regions. So if I plot EC as a function of X, the position, and let's focus on this green line first, which is for 50 nanometer, what you will get is something like this. There will be these barriers here, extra barriers, which are very similar to the halo doping-like barriers, but coming from a totally different phenomena. So these barriers are here because of these fringing field lines. And if you reduce the thickness of the channel now, these fringing field lines become even more and more important. You decrease this, this barrier will go up and up and up. And at very small length, equal to 10 nanometer, these two barriers are going to get merged. So what is happening is that when you reduce the thickness, when you reduce the channel length, instead of the voltage, instead of the barrier lowering, which we get in the normal baseline FET, you can see that as you reduce the channel length, the barrier goes down because of the short channel effect. Because of this fringing field effect in NC FET, we are getting a barrier rise, and that's actually increasing your threshold voltage. The impact was more prominent in case of MF-MIS, which can be very easily understood because there is a metal present here. So this fringing field to the ferroelectric coupling is actually very strong here, and it's an equipotential surface. So not only there will be a rise on the sides, the rise will be in the whole region actually. So you can see that the overall barrier in the whole region will go up. And when you decrease the thickness, when you decrease the channel length, this will go more and more and more up, and you will get a larger threshold voltage compared to the MFIS case. So this now clearly shows why your VT was increasing when you were reducing the channel length. For the reverse SS trends, we can also explain that. So let's focus on the MF-MIS case because that's easier to explain. So SS can be factored into these two terms. So first term is your, actually three terms. So this is your normal 60 millivolt per decade term. There's this M and there's this AFE. M is your normal body factor. AFE is the ferroelectric gain, which is given by this expression of capacitance matching. And I'm writing this, the whole term as some A effective, which is equal to AFE into M inverse. So if A effective is greater than one, your SS will be reducing. So let's see how this M and AFE vary when we reduce the channel length. So for the body factor, we know that when you reduce the channel length, your body factor will degrade. So this M inverse is shown in this plot as a function of length. This is going to degrade. This term will get smaller and smaller, and that's going to degrade your A effective. And let's see what happens to this AFE. So when you reduce the channel length, what happens is that this fringing capacitance become more and more important. So you saw that there were fringing field lines which were coming from two sides actually. So one is from this route. So these are called inner fringing field lines, which go through the body and then couple to this atom. Another set of fringing field lines is through this outer spacer. So this has a different route. Both of these fringing field lines going to contribute an additional capacitance, which will be added to this C internal, the baseline capacitance. So what is going to happen is that when you reduce the thickness, so this plot shows the capacitance as a function of VG for different lengths. Let's just focus on the solid lines first. So this is 50 nanometer. We start from here. As you reduce the thickness, you're seeing that your C int is actually increasing, and it's happening because your fringing capacitance are becoming more and more prominent as you reduce the thickness, as you reduce the channel length, and your ferroelectric capacitance is almost at the same place. So what it's going to do is that when you reduce the channel length, the capacitance matching between the CFE and C int is going to improve. You can see that. And because the capacitance matching is improving, this AFE will increase, which is shown here using these solid symbols and solid black line. And now, so there are two counteracting effect. If your short channel effect in the MOSFET are very high, then this term is going to dominate. On the other hand, if your AFE is very strong, you have a good ferroelectric material and you have good fringing field coupling. So your AFE term is going to dominate, which is happening in our case. Yeah. So AFE dominates with respect to ME in M inverse, and the overall A effective, if you see, it is increasing. It starts to decrease again slightly at very low values of L because of the dominance of this term again. Otherwise, it's increasing. So we can say that as you reduce your channel length, your A effective is increasing, and that's going to bring this subthreshold swing down. So that's why when you were reducing the channel length, the subthreshold swing was actually improving. Now, why it's improving for MFMIS more than the MFIS? It's obvious. I mean, because of the presence of this metal here, the coupling is better. And again, I've shown the case of with and without spacer here. So with spacer, the improvement is more. You can see that the subthreshold swing is smaller compared to the corresponding without spacer case. So you can compare this red to red, blue to blue. It's very obvious. Without spacer, you actually cut off this component of the fringing capacitance. So your outer fringing is gone because there is no spacer. If there's only inner fringing, the overall impact is going to be smaller. It's very obvious. This slide shows the VT and the subthreshold swing as a function of the spacer permittivity, which can be used as a design parameter for the NC FET. As you increase your spacer permittivity, your fringing field effect increases, and all of your reverse threshold voltage increase and the improvement in the subthreshold swing, they are all going to become more and more prominent, which is obvious in this plot. So VT as a function of epsilon is given by these solid lines. You can see as you increase the epsilon, your threshold voltage is increasing more for the MFMIS. And as you increase the permittivity, your subthreshold swing is decreasing more again for the MFMIS. This shows the high VG, the impact of high VD. So we earlier saw that there is this negative Dewhell effect which comes into picture. And this explains that negative Dewhell effect even more. So let's focus on this Dewhell as a function of length plot. So as you reduce your channel length, what happens is that in case of a normal baseline MOSFET, your Dewhell actually starts to degrade. Dewhell starts to increase. But for the NC FETs, if you see, the Dewhell is actually becoming more and more negative. Impact is more in case of MFIS compared to the MFIS, and impact is more in case of spacer as compared to the without spacer case. So it's a very easy to understand thing because we have already seen this EC versus X plots. Let's focus on the MFIS. These dotted lines show the barriers at VD equal to 50 millivolt, low VD, and the solid lines show the barriers at higher VD, which is 0.7 volt in this case. So when you increase the VD, what happens is that on the drain side, you have now more fringing fields because you have increased your VD. So because of the increase in that fringing field, your barrier on the drain side will increase. And overall, now this barrier is actually larger than this dotted line barrier. And if you reduce the channel length, this effect will become more and more prominent. And the difference between this solid line and this dotted line will increase further. So you can see the solid line is above this dotted line, which shows you have a negative Dewhell effect. The picture is even more clearer in the MFMIS case because of the presence of that metal gate that increases the drain to ferroelectric coupling. And you can see the solid line is larger as compared to this dotted line level, and more so for a smaller length case. So all of this explains this figure very well. And if you increase the space of permittivity, you increase the fringing field and your debull will be more and more negative. There's another design parameter which can be used for NC FETs. So that's source drain doping. So this IDVG plot shows the baseline case and the NC FET case. So these curves are for different doping levels, which vary from 10 to the 19 to 4.1, 10 to the 20. And you can see that when we increase the doping, source drain doping in case of your normal MOSFET, your subthreshold characteristics start to actually degrade. The off current is increasing, the subthreshold swing is becoming worse, and your threshold voltage is decreasing. So you can see these trends here. VT as a function of doping, if you plot for the baseline, it's decreasing. Subthreshold swing, it's increasing. Debull is again degrading, it's increasing. So why this is happening, we'll see. But before that, let's focus on the NC FET case. So when you increase the doping here, your subthreshold swing is actually improving. It's exactly the opposite. And your off current is decreasing, your threshold voltage is increasing. You can see here, VT is a function of source drain doping. The VT is increasing, subthreshold swing is improving, the debull is becoming more negative. The impact is again more in case of MFMIS than the MFIS. So let's see. We can easily explain these trends in terms of the band diagrams again. So for the baseline FET, these dotted lines are for the baseline FET. Let's focus on that first. So this line is actually source side Fermi level, which is assumed to be at zero. When you increase the doping from 10 to the 19 to 10 to the 20 levels, you actually get a reduction in the barrier height. And that's obvious because when you increase the doping in the source and drain regions, the space charge actually also increases. Your fringing field is actually increasing. And fringing field work exactly the opposite for your conventional MOSFETs, actually. When you increase the fringing field lines, they will encroach more into the channel, and that will bring these barriers actually down. So that explains all the degrading happening here in the subthreshold region. On the other hand, for the MFIS or MFMIS NC FET, in this case, I've shown MFMIS NC FET, when you increase the doping, this barrier will actually go up because you have now more fringing. More fringing means your negative capacitance effect, that increase in the barrier height, and all of those effects are actually improving with an increase in the fringing field. So you get an improvement in the IDVG characteristics, VT, SS, or debull. So all of that can be explained with the help of this. So I'll now talk about the on regime. Let's skip this. Let's focus on the on regime of a long channel MOSFET. Let's see how MFIS and MFMIS compare to each other at a long channel. And I'm assuming PR at 12.13 microcoulomb per centimeter square. So this is not a very small value. So this is a much larger value compared to the electron density level in a normal MOSFET, which is going to be usually smaller than 5 microcoulomb per centimeter square. And what it ensures is that your negative your MOSFET always stays in the negative capacitance region. So all of these conclusions I'm going to present are only valid when your MOSFET always stays in the negative capacitance region. If PR becomes very small, it becomes comparable to the electron density level in the channel, then the situation becomes different, and I won't cover it here. So let's focus on this case. You can see that the MFMIS is showing a larger on current compared to the MFIS here. And both are, of course, larger than the baseline. In IDVD, if you see, you can see that here too, the red curve is above the blue curve. But you can see there here is that it's VD set, the VD at which the pinch off effect takes place. That voltage, that VD set is higher in case of this IDVD diagram, in case of the MFMIS. And MFIS is somewhere here. And that is causing the current of this MFMIS to be larger than the MFIS. So let's see why that happens. This can be explained in terms of the drain side charge density. As you apply the drain voltage, that drain side charge density actually decreases. And at a particular VD, that actually becomes close to zero, not exactly zero, but we say that the channel has pinched off there. And that particular VD voltage, we call that as VD sat, right? So let's compare the case of MFIS and MFMIS. So these blue lines are for MFIS. These red lines are for MFMIS. And we are going to focus only on the drain side inversion charge density. So let's do that. So let's first focus on the MFIS. You can see here that this pinch off with respect to VD is happening earlier in case of MFIS compared to this MFMIS, which explains these trends. So this can be understood in terms of the fringing field lines and the spatial distribution of the voltage there. So in MFIS, the increase in the VD locally increases the fringing field lines there. So it's a very local effect. As soon as you increase the VD because of the localized drain to channel coupling, it's going to pinch off the channel immediately if it becomes larger than certain voltage. In case of MFMIS, because there's this presence of this metal, so that impact of that fringing field lines, that doesn't get localized. It spreads to the whole channel. So that kind of reduces the overall impact on the drain side itself. The impact is now all over the channel, but you can say the impact on the drain side itself, that has now reduced. So the pinch off is taking place at a larger VD now. And so with the help of this, you can now see why these trends are there and why the current for MFMIS is larger than the MFIS. If you reduce the channel length, what happens is that the difference between this MFMIS and MFIS current, that becomes wider and wider. So because when you reduce the channel length, the fringing field effect become more prominent and your drain to channel coupling or the drain to ferroelectric coupling matters more now. So you can see that MFMIS is still larger than the MFIS. By the way, I've shown here two cases. So in this dotted lines case, I've kept the work function as the same. In this solid line case, I've kept the off current as the same. So usually we usually compare the devices by keeping the off current same. So I will just focus on that. So for the ISO-IOF case, you can clearly see that the solid line is always greater than the corresponding blue lines. And if we have a length equal to 16 nanometer, this difference between these on currents is even larger because obviously when your channel length is smaller, your fringing field effects are going to be larger. Another important thing that you can see in these diagrams is that here there is no apparent negative differential resistance effect. As we reduce the channel length, you see the NDR starts to appear, and at even smaller lengths, the NDR is even worse here, which is again obvious. When you reduce the channel length, your negative capacitance effect increases, and that brings down these current levels a bit. This shows the impact of spacer. When you increase the spacer permittivity, what happens is that because now you have these additional fringing field capacitances and you know that they are going to improve the capacitance matching and then the corresponding gain. Because of that, when you increase the spacer permittivity, your on current also increases because now you're getting more amplification. And both MFIS and MFMIS cases are shown here. This is IDVD, and you can see that as the spacer permittivity increases, your on current is increased. So that's the last part of this talk. I'll quickly cover this. So ultimately, what we want from all of those device characteristics is the circuit performance, right? And if your circuit performance is still bad, then the NC FET is useless. So let's see how our circuit performance is behaving for NC FETs. So this plot shows the ring oscillator delay as a function of the VDD applied. And for several different thicknesses, 0, 5, 8, 10, you can see that for the high VDD region, the improvement in the delay with respect to the baseline is not much. All of these curves are close together. So this red line is here and all of these other lines are actually your NC FETs. In fact, if you see at 0.8, the red line is actually the smallest. So the NC FET is not actually giving any benefit. It's actually degrading the delay here. You start to get the improvement when your VDD is becoming smaller. And in this region, you can see that now NC FET is showing improvement over your baseline FET. So why this is happening? And by the way, this is a particular picture, particular device I've chosen. The trends I'm going to talk about, they are valid, but it can also happen that even in the high VDD case, the NC FET is actually improving the delay. That can happen. But the improvement is going to be worse for the high VDD compared to the low VDD. So that's the overall picture I want to present. So don't take that this is a universal thing. In fact, I'll show you some other diagrams where you will see that for all the VDD, the NC FET is better, but the improvement is more when your VDD is smaller. So this delay, we can approximately assume it to be the switch charge divided by on current, a very crude approximation, but it's good enough to understand these trends. At small VDD, what happens is that, so now before that, for NC FET, both of these quantity become larger. You know that for the same VDD, you now get a larger on current because of the voltage amplification, but you also get a larger capacitance, right? Because if you remember, the total capacitance now become greater than the dielectric capacitance. So there's a capacitance amplification too. And the exact relation is actually this. So CGG is equals to your gain times the internal voltage capacitance, if you want to be exact. So there's this amplification in the capacitance too. So both of these quantities increase, and depending on the VDD, sometimes your on current is going to dominate, sometimes your capacitance is going to dominate. For example, in this regime, the capacitance is actually dominating, and this delta Q is larger than this ion. And in this region, your on current is actually dominating. The improvement in the on current is dominating over the degradation in this delta QG. So you can understand that by this current expression in terms of the internal gate voltage. So current is exponentially dependent on the internal gate voltage, which is given by the gain times the applied VG, roughly. And because of this exponential dependence here, the increase in the on current is actually much larger than the increase in the delta QG. So the delta QG is still roughly linear, but the increase in the on current is exponential. So you get a larger improvement here. Here I show a bigger picture. So in this slide, I'm showing the impact of the NC FET on the standard cell library delay as a 7 nanometer FinFET standard cell library. This is the baseline FinFET. So in a standard cell library, you will have several types of gates. You have combinational circuits, sequential circuits, and you will have a distribution of delay. So there's not a single delay, but a distribution instead. And the distribution for the baseline looks something like this. When you increase your TF, your negative capacitance effect starts to kick in. And the delay distribution, if you see the peak of the delay distribution, it's around 20 picoseconds here. This peak, you can see now it's getting shifting towards left. For TFE2, it shifts more. For TFE3, somewhere here. For TFE4, it's even at a smaller gate delay. So overall picture is that when you increase your TFE, your standard cell library delay, that's actually decreasing, which is what we expect from the NCFET. So our NCFET is actually working here. And this slide shows the relative delay improvements at two VDDs. So at 0.7 volt, you can see that for TFE1, the improvement is only around 15 picoseconds. For TFE2, the improvement goes to 30 picoseconds. For TFE3, it's even more. For TFE4, it's even more. So as you increase the thickness, your improvement in the delay is actually increasing. And by the way, this is at high VDD. So earlier, the thing I was telling you that the trends may not be universal. So that's actually true here. We are, even at high VDD, we are getting improvement in NCFET. But if we reduce the VDD to 0.4 volt, the improvement becomes larger. That was the whole thing I was trying to convey in that slide. So for TFE1, the same TFE1, at 0.4 volt, you get a larger improvement. You can see here, it's around 15 here, it's around 40 here. And for TFE2, you can see the corresponding improvement is larger here. You can compare these, and overall, the VDD equal to 0.4 volt case is showing a larger improvement, which is consistent with what we just saw for the ring oscillator case. This slide shows the impact of your negative capacitance effect on the cell capacitances and the increase in the power also. So you know that with increase in the negative capacitance effect, your capacitance is also going to increase. So for TFE1, the capacitance distribution is somewhere here. And as you increase the thickness, the capacitance also starts to increase. So this is the percentage increase in the capacitance with respect to the baseline. When your capacitance increases, that also increases the power dissipation actually. So when you increase the thickness, the power dissipation is also increasing. So that's a downside. Because when you, in case of NCFET, you are getting smaller delay, your performance is increasing, but your power dissipation is also degrading here. It's increasing. So what do we do now? I mean, we'll have to see again a larger picture. So that I show in the next slide. So is NCFET still overall good? Let's see. So here I show three cases. So the first case show the frequency increase when the VDD for the baseline and the NCFET is kept same. So the VDD is fixed here. And I show the two cases, VDD equal to 0.7 and VDD equal to 0.4. So at the same VDD, you can see that the frequency can be increased with the help of NCFET, and more in the case of 0.4 volt. So these red bars are for 0.4 volt, and you can see that the rise in the frequency is more for VDD equal to 0.4 volt, as I stated earlier. So at the same VDD, we can get a frequency increase very well, but this will also lead to a larger power dissipation, so you'll have to bear that. Okay, so in this plot, what we show is a better picture. It shows a frequency increase under the constraint of constant power density. So that's where we are actually interested in. So it shows that you can still get an increase in the frequency, keeping the power as constant. So the overall NC FET is still better. For TFE1, you have a minor improvement, but for higher thicknesses, your increase in the frequency is actually higher. Of course, you will have to correspondingly reduce the VDDs also to keep the power power density constant, but it doesn't matter because eventually we are increasing our frequency still. The last figure shows for the same performance, how much power we are able to reduce with the help of negative capacitance. So this is for the same frequency. Are we able to reduce the power? Yes. For TFE1, not so much. For TFE2, yes, we are getting a 10% increase. For TFE3 or TFE4, we are getting even more reduction in the power. So overall picture is that the NC FET is better. And that's the last slide, I guess. Yes, so in summary, we can see that NC can be used to achieve steep SS and larger ion compared to the conventional FETs. Several unconventional effects we saw, the negative Dibble, negative differential resistance, fringing field, et cetera, and they can be used to our advantage if we design the NC FET closely. So in conventional sense, the fringing field or these fringing fields can be a burden, but for NC FET, it's improving if we control it. And negative Dibble, if you see, so up to certain level, negative Dibble is good. You want the Dibble to be less, but it shouldn't be very negative because for analog application, you will not then get these large NDR regions, and that's going to cause issues. Even for the digital devices, if you have a large NDR regions, that will cause a hysteresis in your inverter characteristics. So we don't want this to be too much, but up to certain level, this is fine, and we can actually tune that. And we saw that the scaling the channel length can also be beneficial for NC FETs up to certain extent. And the design parameters, the design knobs we have in hand is the ferroelectric material, first of all. So the ferroelectric material, the ferroelectric materials are, because we are talking about the CMOS compatibility here. So the material, the base material is going to be fixed. It's going to be HFO2 doped with something, and the doping level can be tuned to achieve different alpha, beta, gamma, those Landau constants. And accordingly, you can tune your S curves. The other parameter is your ferroelectric thickness. For the baseline FET, the other parameters can be the spacers, source drain doping, and you can also play with the underlap or overlap lens, which can then change your overlap capacitances. That I haven't shown, but that can also be tuned. So these are the design parameters. We saw that ideally MFMIS shows a better performance compared to the MFIS in both the off region and on region, but that's a very ideal case. In practice, this metal can cause issues. For example, it has been shown that if there's even a slight leakage through the ferroelectric and there's this metal present there, it's going to destabilize the negative capacitance state. People have also shown that this presence of metal can lead to the domain formation in the ferroelectric, which will actually reduce your overall gain of the NC. So theoretically, it's very good. Practically, it can be challenging. Unless it's ideal, it's going to be very challenging. So practically, the more focus right now is on MFIS type of FETs. Even even if it shows actually smaller improvements compared to the MFMIS. Finally, negative capacitance FET, it's a potential candidate. What we right now are looking is to find optimum ferroelectric materials which have good properties. More focus is on the hafnium type, hafnium oxide based ferroelectric. And a lot of progress has been made, but a lot of progress is still to be done. We also need to deal with the non-ideal effects such as grains. So it can happen that if your area of the device is large, there can be several grains in the ferroelectric itself. And that will lead to a totally different type of switching, which is called KAI type of switching. So if someone wants to search, it's called Kolmogorov, Pavarami, Ishibashi type of switching. So it's a very, very different type of switching mechanism, and that does not lead to a stable static negative capacitance. So what we get for these cases are a transient negative capacitance. That's a very difficult to control thing. So we don't want too many grains in our devices, which is actually kind of true also if we are working for short channel devices. So it can happen that there is only a single grain, but if there are multiple grains, we need to deal with that. The other thing is that the domain formation can lead to a reduction in the gain. So if you have a single grain and there are these domains in the ferroelectric, for example, say 180 degree type of domains. So polarization within the ferroelectric itself is up, down, up, down, up, down. So that overall domain formation, actually that can reduce the ferroelectric gain. And that's also a topic of concern which need to be studied more. And we need to find ways how to deal with that. Ferroelectric leakage can be another thing. As I told you, the leakage can actually disturb the negative capacitance state itself. So that needs to be dealt with, and defects can also cause. So defects are actually, if there are defects present, a lot of defects in the ferroelectric regions, they can act as soft spots and they can lead to, again, a totally different type of switching, which I told you for the grains. And they act as the nucleation center. So then ferroelectric switching happens because of the nucleation and growth. That's called a nucleation and growth mechanism. And that's a totally different mechanism. And the negative capacitance is only achievable in the form of transient negative capacitance then. And that's not we want. We want a stable negative capacitance, as I showed you in this presentation. So these are all the challenges, but still it looks very good candidate for the future applications. So that was the NC FET. If you have any questions, please ask.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
I want to model MFIS structure, that means MFIS structure, in COMSOL multiphysics. So how can I model regular ferroelectric materials that can act as a negative capacitor? Is there any sort of physics other than LK or any properties or boundary condition I have to add so that I can change the behavior of ferroelectric FET to negative capacitance FET?
Yeah, so the inbuilt material in the COMSOL are not going to work. You'll have to add your own physics. So LK is a good start. You can use LK model in the ferroelectric region. COMSOL lets you do that. You can specify your own equations. You can also specify your boundary conditions. If you want to know more about it, you can just refer to my thesis. It's online, and I've explained all the boundary conditions, all the physics, and how you do that in the COMSOL. I even copy pasted the pictures of the COMSOL graphical user interface, and you can get the help you need from there.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Any other question?
Sir, I have one question.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, if we want to change the equation in TCAD software, like any equations, like band gap equations, so can we change the new equation? Can we derive the new equation for the TCAD?
So the TCAD you are talking about now, CentOS gives you a limited capability to do that. So you can change the models, only a few models, but in a very limited way. And in the manual, you can see actually so there is some provision, but the flexibility is not that much. I'm comparing it with the, for example, COMSOL. So COMSOL lets you do everything. You can specify anything. The CentOS won't let you do that. But the downside for the COMSOL is that you will get a lot of convergence issues when you try to add new equations. And yeah, so that's the downside.
Okay. Sir, in your slide number 18, you have mentioned the one structure where the ferroelectrics are deposited in the vertical, in the lateral direction. So is it only representation or some thing other?
So you're
yes, talking sir, about this
one. Yeah, yes, it's sir. Possible. It's very much possible. I mean, you also deposit an HFO2 layer, right?
Yes, sir. So we can deposit in the vertical and the gate in the around the fin only. So, but here you deposited the lateral side in the board side. So is there any
specific?
Yes, sir. This is any reason or just simply?
It's a schematic actually, but I mean, some portion of that also gets deposited on the sides also. Yeah, I mean, it's more of, we don't want it here. I mean, it's not doing anything. So it's just that the process is such that you will also get something here. For example, you can see it here. See, whatever you deposit on the fin will also get deposited on the sides also. I mean, you can do much about it. You can do much about that. It's the process thing, and it's not disturbing anything as such.
So we won't get a different result either we put the layer or not.
No, I mean the channel is here, right? And this is not the channel.
But we have to apply the voltage at the side also.
Yeah, but you don't have source drain here, right?
Yes,
if you see, the source drain is only for the fin. There is no source drain here, so there won't be any current conduction. There may be some charge induced below this, but yes, that's unwanted anyways. We don't want it. Yeah.
Okay.
That will lead to your, what is called, it's called that, it will lead to some parasitic capacitance actually between the gate and the substrate. It's called gate to substrate capacitance, overlap capacitance. That's unwanted, but we can't do much about that.
Okay.
Yeah. Anybody else?
So I have a question.
Yeah.
So there are two models, LK model and LGD model. So are they both same or different?
They are different actually. So the LGD model, you can say it's an advanced version of the LK model. LGD model has these polarization gradient terms also. So that takes care of the domain energy, domain wall energy, and all of the gradients involved in the polarization. Yes, so with the help of the LGD model, you can actually model the domains also.
So, sir, as compared to LK model, LGD will be better.
Of course, it will be better, but it's going to be more computationally challenging. It may require, it might be difficult to converge also. But I think the CentOS now has that LGD. So, yes.
Yes, sir. In one of your papers about GIDL, you included LGD model.
Yes.
So instead of LK.
Yeah.
So if you include LK models, sir, the results will be same or something different, sir?
Result will be, of course, different for the LGD, but I would say the trends won't be different. The trends will be same. Unless you really start to form these domains,
Otherwise, the trends are going to be similar.
Sir, I have one question, sir. In LK model, sir, there is a term called row, sir.
Mm-hmm.
So, sir, how it will affect, what is the significance of it and how it will affect the delay performance of NCFET when using in circuit?
So that row term, if you are talking about the Landau type switching, and if you have a single grain and small size capacitor, which we are going to have for our application for state-of-the-art FinFETs, that row term should not affect the things much. It has been shown that the impact of that row term will be very small, so that the delay caused by that term is actually similar to the polarization delay which you get in a dielectric. So they are not fundamentally different. The row term becomes important when you have a large number of grains or your capacitor area is very large. So then this row term is going to play a big role. Otherwise, it's fine. There have been experimental demonstrations where they showed that they were able to fit the ring oscillator delay using a normal DC modeling, which didn't have any row term. And that was why Global Foundry. In fact, I may have that slide. Let me see. Oh, yes, this. Yeah, so you see this row term here doesn't have much impact. What happens is that actually the charge you are going to switch, it's going to be very small compared to the remnant polarization of the ferroelectric material. So the charge you are going to switch is going to be roughly equal to 1 microcoulomb per centimeter square. This is the level of charge density what we get in the MOSFETs. And to switch this much amount of charge, you don't require full polarization switching from minus polarization state to plus polarization state. So what people confuse it is within conventional switching of the polarization. So they think that, oh, because you have this delay effects when you go from the minus polarization to the plus polarization state, and it's very evident in the isolated ferroelectric capacitance experiment. So that should also be the case in the NCFETs, but it's not, because you are not switching fully from minus to plus state. You are just switching a fraction of that. To switch fraction of that, you don't require too much of time. So the time will still be in the picosecond, you can see. And this row term does not play that much of a big role there. If you are trying to just switch this small amount of charge. And these are those experiments I was talking about. This is a ring oscillator delay, and these solid curves are actually the modeling. And this is DC modeling. So they are showing that even if we assume this to be zero, they are still able to fit that experimental delay. It means that this term does not cause much of a shift in the delay.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Sure. Any other question? Okay, if not, so let's conclude this session and.
So can we have a minute, sir?
I'm sorry.
So can we contact you if we have some doubts in future?
Yeah, contact me on my email.
So can we have your mail ID?
So it's simply just my last name, bhava@berkeley.edu.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sure. So thank you all for attending and listening to my presentation. It's over time, but yeah, it was great to see you guys here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.